Good morning. Welcome to the biblical explanation for the Solemnity of All Saints. The Gospel reading includes the Beatitudes from the Gospel according to Matthew. In the lectionary, the Gospel reading starts at verse 1 of chapter 5, that includes the first two verses that is not only introduction to the Beatitudes, but to the entire Sermon on the Mount, and goes up to first part of verse 12 with words, "Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven." But the second part of verse 12, that is the conclusion to the Beatitudes, is not included in the lectionary, "for they so persecuted the prophets who were before you." So the Beatitude starts from verse 3 and end with verse 12. The Beatitudes, in fact, open the first collection of speeches of Jesus in the Gospel according to Matthew, so they have a character of an introduction, particular introduction that is so dense that includes the important topics, ideas that will be developed in the course of the Gospel according to Matthew. Therefore, today's procedure will be to make references only and exclusively to some selected passages in the Gospel according to Matthew. In the introduction itself at verse 2, that Jesus opened his mouth and taught them, saying, the verb opening can recall the saying of Jesus in chapter 7, verses 7 and 8, "Knock and it will be opened to you. To him who knocks, it will be opened." This opening can be understood in the sense also spiritual. The understanding of Jesus requires effort, in particular effort in application of his words in daily life. The poor in the spirit could be read from the perspective of the statement in chapter 9, verse 21. Jesus said to the young man, "If you would be perfect, go sell what you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me." But in particular, the story about the anointing of Jesus in chapter 26, when the disciples saw it, they were indignant, saying, "Why this waste? For this ointment might have been sold for a large sum and give to the poor." The disciples were not understanding the meaning of this anointing, therefore Jesus explains them, "Why do you trouble the woman? For she has done a beautiful thing to me. For you always have the poor with you, but you will not always have me. In pouring this ointment on my body, she has done it to prepare for my burial." And immediately that anointing is followed by the story of the betrayal of Jesus by Judas. Then the one of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and said, "What will you give me if I deliver him to you?" And they paid him 30 pieces of silver. And from that moment he sought an opportunity to betray him. From the perspective of this text, the poor in the spirit is not about the economic poverty, but about the internal disposition towards material things. The young man was unable to follow Jesus because he was unable to give up his riches. Judas sold Jesus for money. Those who mourn, we can relate to the story, the accusation and question of the Pharisees posed to Jesus, why his disciples do not fast. In chapter 9, then Jesus answers them, "Can the wedding guests mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them? The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast." From this perspective, it's not about any kind of mourning, but the mourning that is related to Jesus, to his suffering and death. The meek. Jesus himself gives example of meekness. In chapter 11, verse 29, he says, "Take my yoke upon you, and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly of heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, we can relate it to the parable of judgment in chapter 25. The righteous are declared blessed, and the reason for that statement starts with these words: For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. On the contrary, the wicked are declared cursed with this reason: For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. So not only the pair of verbs to be hungry and thirsty links with the beatitude, but also the concept itself of being blessed or cursed relates so much to the concept of beatitudes. The merciful can be read from the perspective of the parable of the unmerciful servant, when the master says to him, Should not you have shown mercy to your fellow servant as I had mercy on you? That unmerciful servant, before he received mercy, but that mercy was withdrawn from him because of lack of his mercy towards his fellows. The pure in heart could be related to the Pharisees and to their understanding of purity, focusing in particular on ritual purity, external purity, and the Jesus words addressed to them in chapter 23, verse 26. You blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup and of the plate, then the outside also may be clean. The peacemakers could be read in the imminent context in the Gospel according to Matthew in the same chapter 5, when Jesus is making correction of some regulations, interpretations of the law. Jesus quotes the Jewish tradition saying, You have heard that it was said, You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and the good. He sends rain on the just and on the unjust. In the conclusion he states, You therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. The concept of sonship in this saying of Jesus about loving the enemies is so strong because it refers that you may be sons of your Father and to be perfect as your heavenly Father. It goes so much in line with the promise given to the peacemakers that they shall be called sons of God. This teaching about love refers also to the beatitude of the merciful. Those are the selected references which I made in order not to make this exposition too long, because the Beatitudes, in fact, relate so much to the entire content of the Gospel. I did not mention any related text quotation to the eighth Beatitude about those persecuted, because in fact that eighth Beatitude is developed in the ninth, the last Beatitude, where the concept of the persecution is repeated. Now let us look at the composition of the Beatitudes. Most probably you learned and you remember that they are from the Catechism, that there are eight Beatitudes. However, when we look here at the text of Matthew, there are nine. But it is true, the first eight have the same pattern. In Greek, they start with word makairoi, here I translated by happy, followed by the article hoi, also here I translated with the article, and after that, there is an adjective or the participle, which has the same function as the adjective. And the second part in Greek also starts with a particle hoti, which here is translated in all eight instances by four, and then the first one and the eighth one are exactly the same, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. While in the middle, after the particle, there is they, and they are following verbs translated by shall become forth, shall inherit the earth, and so on. The same expression, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven, in the first, in the eighth beatitude, function as an inclusion that marks the beginning and the end of particular textual unit. So therefore, if you learn in the catechism that there are eight beatitudes, it is a proper also distinction of those eight beatitudes from the ninth one, which has different character. The first eight are addressed to the third person plural, happy the poor. It means we could say happy they who are poor, and therefore that statement that they are happy, the other people, as a point of reference, as a vocation that we are called to become, but probably we are not yet feeling that we are part of it. While the last beatitude, the ninth one, is formulated differently, happy are you, it is used the second person plural form. Jesus is addressing it to those who hear him, his disciples. In the extension also, he's addressing it to us. This beatitude takes the word persecution from the eight beatitudes and develops it, because the whole ninth beatitude is dedicated to the persecution, when they revile you and persecute you and utter all kind of evil against you falsely for my sake, and then conclusion, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. The first eight beatitudes could be named as general statements, as the ideals to become, while the ninth beatitude is a realistic, is a call for application. In other words, the ninth attitude requires application of all eight proceedings, in particular in the time of difficulties as persecution. Here in those beatitudes, I translated the Greek word makairoi purposely by happy, not blessed, because in the middle, at verse 12 of the last beatitude, there is double call to joy. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. And that statement about the reward in heaven links to the double statement at the end of the first and the eighth beatitude, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And you can observe that in verse 6 and 10 there appears word righteousness, hungry and thirsty for righteousness, and later persecuted for the sake of righteousness. Those two statements are problematic, create problems in the interpretation. However, we can understand what is meant by this word righteousness if we translate also very carefully the particular expression here in verse 10, for the sake, and also in verse 11, for my sake. The whole persecution described in verse 11 is for the sake of Jesus, because of Jesus. Therefore also the beatitude in verse 10, persecuted for the sake of righteousness, means for the sake of Jesus. As well also hungry and thirsty for righteousness means also hungry and thirsty for Jesus in verse 6. And the same of understanding of hungry and thirsty for righteousness in verse 6, we could also get when we link it to the parable of the judgment in chapter 25, when Jesus says that blessed are you, because when I was hungry, you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. Wishing all of you a nice day, a happy feast of All Saints, and a nice reflection on the Beatitudes.